Hello, welcome to the Quad.
Won't you lend your lungs to me?
Podcast.
Mine are collapsing. Plant my feet and bitterly breathe up the time that's past. Breath I'll take and breath I'll give. Pray the day's not poised. Stand among the ones that live in lonely indecision.
Welcome to episode 40 of the Crackpot Podcast with James LaFon and Lynn Lockhart. Good morning, James.
Good morning, Lynn.
How are you?
Oh, I'm doing fine. I won't write this, but on Monday night, Big Ron and I decided to close the bar. He's back to work today. This is Wednesday the 13th, and Big Ron is back to work.
Wow.
The Trump economy has sucked him in. There's so much construction going on. The whole time he's been healing up, he's been fielding job offers to be a layout guy because he was a foreman before a guy translates the blueprints into the, you know, the actual string and chalk model. And he finally went with one of these. His physical therapy was a dead end as far as getting him back to being a carpenter. So he's going to have to be,
a boss kind of guy.
Yes, yeah. He's going to be out there with the foreman, making sure that everything's level and straight and the corners are flush. And I brought a limited amount of money to the bar with me so I wouldn't drink too much.
Uh-huh.
And he kept pulling out money after I ran out, and he eventually got me home. I think I drank 7 pitchers of beer. This is ridiculous. It was Viking levels of drinking. We just nice conversation between him and I and a few older guys that were all in construction at this bar. And I was already pretty embarrassed when I walked through the door, and I went downstairs.
You went downstairs?
To use the bathroom in the basement.
Sure.
And, then I woke up. There's this giant ottoman down there that the riches have, okay? And so I went downstairs not to wake up the riches from their slumber. And I don't remember laying down, but I remember waking up with my feet on the floor, my back on this giant ottoman, and a very lopsided hangover. You know, it's, I don't get hangovers that often, but this one was mostly on the left side of my head. Later on, I was told that Mr. Rich came downstairs because the dogs discovered that I had undone the doggy gate, and they went on an adventure in the basement, and even though one of them was standing on my chest licking my face, I was still snoring away. So I apparently got molested by the miniature greyhound.
Okay.
So when I finally got up and rinsed out my mouth and looked in the mirror, I saw that walking down the stairs of the basement, I'd smashed my head into the bumper, the wooden molding where the stairway breaks through the ceiling into the basement.
And it's kind of
I guess I just said to hell with it and laid down on the ottoman after I smacked my head.
And, okay.
There you go. So
that was 48 hours ago, or roughly, I guess, or 36.
Right.
So you feeling good? Feeling better?
Yeah, I think that my reading has improved. I couldn't really write yesterday, but I did some pretty keen reading, and I was actually able to finally decipher the notice that Wells Fargo Bank sent me as to how to activate my new chip card, and I couldn't figure it out when I looked at it. But after Big Ron ran his CD cleaner through my hard drive, which I think was like, 3 gallons of Yuengling draft, suddenly everything was clear to me again. It was uncluttered, and I was actually able to read the directions on how to activate my my new bank card.
Okay, so we were talking about Big Ron. He's back to work, and you mentioned the economy. So what's going on? What do you see in the economy there?
Oh, well, it's a ton of construction work. Ron's attributing it to Trump. Just like when I talked to him and this fellow Stoker that got stomped by the pagans, he had been a tow truck operator, and he operated tow trucks that hauled trucks and buses that got repossessed. And he said when the Obama administration kicked off, all these coal mines in Tennessee closed down. So he spent a lot of time hauling mining equipment out of Tennessee to take it to either the West Coast or the East Coast, depending on where the insurer or the bank wanted it to go. When I told Ron this, he said he knew guys that were mill workers who got paid a lot of money for going to China and setting this mining equipment up over in China. A lot of this Tennessee mining equipment was sold to the Chinese and American went over there.
That was going to be my guess for where he was towing it. It was probably to the ports to ship it to China.
And also during that administration, a railroad materials manufacturing company in Baltimore, Maryland, on North Point Boulevard, was acquired by the Yangtze's Railroad. So we now have our one of our heavy industries in Baltimore is actually owned by this Chinese company. And that also happened in that period. So he said he's itching to go back to work, and he's had so many offers. The other thing that happened was the wages in construction being bid down by operators who were hiring illegal aliens. That's pretty much stopped because basically the Mexican guys got together with the American guys, and guys like Ron told him, you shouldn't be working for $8 or $10 an hour. You should be making $30 an hour like me. So they actually built an alliance between the Mexican and surviving Anglo workers. You have so few young American men want to do this work that you've got guys my age and 10 years older coming out of retirement, these old white guys to work alongside these Mexican guys who are now getting paid the same. And it's really allowed the white guys to get back into the market. And it looks like it's going to be a healthier situation as far as quality goes, guys, too. So it looks like a new generation in construction right now where you got experienced white guys working with young Mexican dudes. And Ron just told me, and the other older guys at the bar that were 10 years older than me, they were all construction guys. They said nobody under 30, no white man under 30 right now is willing to do any type of physical labor. So that's the pair up you got right now. It's basically older white dudes and younger Mexican guys working together. But the white guys could get a decent wage again, and the Mexican guys are making a lot more money too.
So that's from the wage and labor supply angle. What about projects? Is he seeing more projects starting or changing, or what's going on?
Yes,
that?
A lot. And it's around the Baltimore, D.C. area. And the other thing is the problem with in the Baltimore area of finding anybody that's not on drugs that can pass a drug test, because these outfits, all the insurance companies that insure people like Ron for when they fall off of buildings, they demand drug testing on a part of the employer. And he said the lady at the agency where he got tested said that, you know, he was one of the only people coming out of Baltimore that could even pass the drug test. So there's, again, if you're not on dope, there's a lot of employment opportunities in construction in the Baltimore, Washington area. And I know from being up in Manhattan, I saw a half a dozen high-rise residential buildings and office buildings going up that were not yet completed.
That's all good news for the LaFon demographic. Okay, what do you know about the Catane Monument in Jersey City?
Okay, first of all, there is one in Baltimore. There is one in Brooklyn, I believe. And there is one in Jersey City, New Jersey. And it is of a Polish officer being bayoneted in the back by a Russian soldier. 10 or 12,000 of these guys were just rounded up and murdered by the Russians in the Katyn Forest. I don't know exactly how to pronounce it. Now, at the same time, other officers were, like Rawez Shwerez, his story is represented in the movie The Way Back that actually has Colin. He played Alexander the Great. His first name's Colin. I can't remember his last name.
Farrell?
Yeah. Okay, he plays in this movie along with Ed Harris, and there were some inaccuracies about it, but Rawez Shwerez and six other men walked out of Siberia to India, and there were cattle cars of Polish guys were actually loaded up and sent into Siberia to build their own gulags. So it wasn't just the 10 to 12,000 guys, officers that got murdered in that forest. These other ones were also fed into the Soviet prison system and sent out to gulags. The book is titled The Long Walk. It's probably the best real adventure you ever read. They, in the movie, they wrote the American character out at the end. This was actually funded by Polish and British film interests. So the key character was the American character who had been an engineer in Moscow, and he got caught up in one of these sweeps by Stalin. And he was the guy that actually was able to speak to the British authorities in Nepal and get him and the other three men into a hospital. And actually, the guy that wrote the book doesn't know what ended up happening to the American. But Richard Harris is the American in the movie, and they write him out of the script. He just goes wandering off in the Himalayas by himself before they can meet the rescue party. He's got somewhere else to go, you know. In other words, they don't want an American having a key role in this movie. And the Colin Farrelly character in the movie, the criminal, he didn't exist. He was just put in there so that young people could identify with, like, a criminal-type character.
Some drama, yeah.
Okay, but the other characters were authentic, and the rest of the movie was pretty well done.
I think I remember reading your review of that movie.
Yeah, and it was, I mean, the book is fantastic. People should read it. Well, anyhow, there is, I made some connections in Jersey City when I was up there with The Sopranos. Some of the people that I met up there told me that a Polish community organization is actually protesting the removal of the statue. The statue is being removed by the mayor and the city council because they consider it an eyesore because it's violent.
All right.
Some of my white nationalist friends think that it's a certain religious ethnic demographic behind it because they were the same guys putting the bayonets in the back of the Polish soldiers. But I don't think the command of history amongst our civic leaders is that high to even realize that they're trying to, you know, that what they're trying to do might obscure a crime by somebody that might have been distantly related to them. I just think it's because we're in the age of the POC martyr, and the universal villain is the white man, and this is obviously a white man that's being martyred, that's being done to death from behind, and I just think that's why it can't stand. It's just not the right image.
I'm getting ready to publish Shelters for the Self for you. And this is something, I'm not really plugged into movies. I haven't watched a movie in many years. But from what I can gather, it's like there's no World War II movies that even deal with the Pacific Theater in recent years, are there?
There was one that was recently, it was produced by Mel Gibson, about a conscientious objector.
Okay.
I forget the title of it. The next one back was Wind Talkers, which was a kind of a ridiculous movie where Nicolas Cage kills like 10,000 Japanese guys by himself trying to protect this Navajo radio operator, because they use Navajos in the Pacific to confound the Japanese that listened in. Before that, you have Flags of Our Fathers, which is a very good movie. I think Clint Eastwood was involved in it, and it was about Iwo Jima and about determining who was actually raising the flag, who raised that flag. And the first flag was not raised by the guys you see raising it in the iconic film. It was done a couple of different times, and it turns out that most of these guys end up getting killed in short order. So they recruit other guys that weren't even there, that were part of the same unit, to go around flag raisers. That was the story with that. The Thin Red Line before that, which is a really good movie about Guadalcanal. Those are about every 5 years you get a Pacific movie, and they seem to be much better balanced and more treating the enemy like human beings than the ones dealing with the war in Europe, which have become cartoonish in their treatment of the German combatants.
Well, that's something that struck me because this book, Shelters for the Self, is the transcription of a diary that you found among your friend's belongings, and another reader also contributed a great deal to it by figuring out which engagement it was and found the history book that covered it from the Department of Defense. And so it's a really cool project, and it's going to come out really soon. It'll be out by the time this podcast goes up, so I just wanted to mention it.
Thanks. That young man saved me a world of embarrassment because I had actually located it on Saipan.
Yeah.
Which is about 1,000 miles from where we have it.
And another reader who's remaining anonymous even did a little, he lives in Japan, he did a little bit of detective work. So we probably know where the prefecture where Koyama came from. And there's a few other names in the book. So I'm hoping that people in Japan will be able to follow up some more with that as well. So it's a cool thing to have.
Well, thanks for working on that. I know it's been a lot of work.
Oh, no, I'm enjoying it. It's almost done. The next topic, I think, is a little bit of general podcast business. People have probably noticed that we haven't been podcasting as often as usual. And so we were going to talk about that as well. So what can you tell us about how podcasting affects your writing and your energy levels and things like that?
I did a lot of it over the last year, and it's not just this podcast. The other podcasts I've been on have generally taken about 5 hours of my time as far as just the talking time. It's been positive when I've prepared written material to go along with the Myth of the 20th Century podcast. That's resulted in a net gain in my writing. But the concept is really dissipation is the best way to explain it. When you're training to fight, you don't want to talk a lot. You don't want to socialize a lot. And you don't want to have sex, okay, because it's interaction with other people that spreads you out there, and it actually dissipates your force, and for lack of a better term. And I've found this is a big concept about 120 years ago. I found that that has had the same effect on me. If I do more than an hour a day of speaking or socializing, which I'm sure is not much for most people, then it actually reduces my desire to write. Part of the reason why I began writing and why I've written so much is because I hardly know anybody in my personal life that I could speak to about anything without them just like gawking in horror and running away or stopping the conversation. Well, now I've met a lot of people online that I'd like to speak to like this, and now people in person when I go and visit. And when I do that, it does reduce my writing. So while I'm at home, I'm going to try to do less podcasting. Lynn and I think we're thinking about putting one out like every 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks, you know, at least one a month. Because for one thing, it's a ton of work for her. And she's also trying to help me edit these books. Sorry, I was just talking about you in the third person while I was looking at me. It's kind of weird. I felt like a professional wrestler there for a moment.
Well, I completely agree. I completely agree. Producing one a week is a lot of work for me. And that I really enjoy talking with you. And I think we have lots to talk about. But it's the behind-the-scenes work that...
The supervising of the children while podcasting is one thing.
Supervising the kids and they're screaming. But I really like to have really high production standards in our podcast. I think we do a pretty good job compared to some of the others out there. And it's an amateur podcast for sure. But I like it to sound as good as it can. And it takes some time to do that. And it takes some time to prepare. So I think we can do...
Especially since Lynn's using Skype. We're using Skype, and there's problems with that. The reason why we're not using Audacity to record this is because I'm a tech tard, and my brain melts when I have to deal with something like that. And Audacity records on both ends at the same time. And then the guy that's not doing the recording... the overall recording, then sends his half the recording there. And that was just, when I did that with Kevin Michael Grace and Kevin Steele, I was just about done with it right there. I said, I'm not going to do any more Audacity. it was work for me.
I know, I couldn't do that to you. It would probably sound a little bit better, but it sounds pretty good this way, I think.
Okay. I really appreciate it. I enjoy doing these a lot. And we'll keep doing them, but it'll be, you know, it's not going to be every week or every other week. It'll be every 3 or 4 weeks.
Yeah, I think aiming for every 3 weeks would probably be fine. And it's always according to your inspiration, you know, if something comes up, it's always here. So you can always just give me a call and we'll do it.
Well, which is how we scheduled this one. I have spoken to some people. Lynn has spoken to some people. Probably every other podcast is going to be with a guest, and we decided we're not going to do celebrity guests. Okay, you don't have to worry about us talking to Stefan Molyneux or Black Pigeon or anybody like that. It's going to be non-celebrity, non-media people. We'll be speaking with the Sea Daddy, the Checkered Demon. At some point, we're going to be speaking to the Christian Soldier, Sean, and also Tony Cox, who I'm meeting later this summer. And, of course, Big Ron, whenever Big Ron is free from his construction duties.
Yeah, we've okay. missed Ron twice now, I think.
Oh, I think we'll continue in a productive and interesting manner.
Yeah, I'm in total agreement on that as well, that our guests shall be readers and listeners and not anybody with a higher profile than what we have, which is pretty darn low. So.
Well, I thought about it. That's the tone. All the Harm City stuff, I really continue doing that because it's miniature biographies, snapshot biographies of people that are not celebrities. And I don't like to say ordinary people because they're not all ordinary. Okay.
Right.
Some of them are extraordinary, but it's just people that aren't celebrities. I'm really not interested, unless it's discussing a boxer's form or a general's conduct in war or ancient heroics. I'm not interested in famous people. I'm interested in, you know, people that are at the human level and seeing what that's about. And reading history, you'll find that's the slimmest batch of material out there, is what is it like for the normal person. You're lucky to find a couple of letters from a Roman soldier, but you've got reams of stuff written by their statesmen and about their generals and so forth. So we're going to try to provide material for the future thinkers of the world about what it's like to be a real person.
I agree completely once again that it's going to be, like you say, not ordinary people, but people who are not otherwise examined very closely and who have very interesting stories to tell.
I'm taking one more trip to Pennsylvania in June to look at some Plantation in America sites with Nero the Pict. July 10th, I take a train out of Baltimore to head for Denver. I'll spend a week with the Checkered Demon in a hideaway in a canyon somewhere, you know, within 100 miles of Denver. Okay. Hopefully it's where the Hole in the Wall gang used to hide out. And then I will be joined there by Ishmael. We'll go back to Salt Lake City and spend time in Utah and Wyoming. We're going to meet Tony Cox, I think in Wyoming, and go up Medicine Wheel Mountain. So, which seems doable, and it has to be done before the end of August.
Oh, is it for the weather? Does it get?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not safe going up the pass after, I think, August 28th, something like that.
Okay.
And then September 19th, I'll get a train out of Salt Lake City, come back to Baltimore for a couple of days. Then we've got the last weekend of September. I'll be dueling with machetes at Sean's Man Weekend. I'm not going to do the boxing, okay? And Arik and Sean are going to do a glove prequel to their 2019 bare knuckle match that they're going to have. They're going to do a real London Prize Ring Rules bare knuckle match on turf with cleats.
Wow.
Okay. We should have like a dozen guys at this Man Weekend. There's going to be a few guys coming from Jersey, And then when we're done, I'm going to leave with them and go back to New Jersey.
Oh my goodness.
There's a boxer that works at Manny Soprano's strip club that's actually a pro fighter that wanted to work with me on his jab. Okay. Guy's name is Farouk. Big dude, about as big as Lennox Lewis.
Oh wow.
Yeah. I wouldn't even be able to hold the mitts for him.
I knew about your trip out west, but I didn't know about the other stuff, so that's exciting. And I just finished reading about Sean and Arik, and that is pretty exciting too. I'm sure someone will take video, so we have that to look forward to.
That's going to be the first legit London Prize Ring rules boxing match in like 100 and wow. They started compromising 1890, 91, I think was the last real bare knuckle boxing match. So yeah, you're talking 130 years ago. So we'll bring that back, and Big Ron wants the winner.
Yeah, you guys are starting something really interesting.
So it's a pioneer activity. Now I'll do the machete dueling because it's not that dangerous. And what makes it dangerous is when you have inexperienced people doing it,
And so who
and
are you going to be
people,
dueling with then?
right? People who are cavemen, whoever wants to. I know two guys that are ready to do it at a high level, which would be Arik and Sean. But any of the other guys that would like to do it, we can do a limited version where I will only touch them where their gear is, you know, their glove and their fencing mask, and they don't have to worry about getting one of these things jammed into their gut because dull steel will still go in you. So we'll do it on gravel instead of grass. You can't do it on a slippery thing because somebody might get run through. So you have to do it. There's a gravel walkway underneath of the porch that's very high. The porch is like 15 feet high. So we could do it under there and have good footing. And in case it's raining, we wouldn't be stabbing each other with rusty machetes. So it would just be a way for anybody that wanted to try steel, I would be there to do it with them. And it would also be a way for Arik and Sean to size each other up for doing a steel duel as well, because they're both interested in doing that. They both want to fight with steel weapons, and they're both ready because they've done a lot of stick fighting and they've done a lot of blunt knife fighting. So I'll basically be, I'm really not in much danger dealing with anybody with machetes because I'm hard to get to with that. Timing counts for more. I expect to be running these young men through and cutting their necks and not getting touched. All right.
All right.
Okay, so yeah, I'm done with competitive stick fighting and boxing. I might do a senior citizen boxing sparring thing with Manny. He was looking for somebody that wouldn't rip his head off because he's about my age too. So you know, we'll go out there and probably do a hands of mud demonstration. But not going to. My nose doesn't have the elasticity. The last time Eric face masked me when we were sparring with the sticks, I had to pop my nose back out. It didn't
Oh,
like back out by itself. So
don't do
get
that.
punched. It's just going to crunch up really easily. It
Oh,
just doesn't
man.
have the spring back that it had. So
For those who don't know, about 6 months ago now, end of last year, James had a major nose break when he face planted in his own bedroom.
yes. I was attacked by a white desk and finished off by a hardwood floor, so I guess it's kind of like having a white guy and a Puerto Rican come after me in my own
Well,
room.
you're your own worst enemy, I think.
Right. So I have enough trouble not knocking myself out these days. So
Yeah. So the
we'll
nose is still healing and probably will never quite be the same, let's face it. That
do.
was
Yeah, I can
major.
tell. It's just not.
Yeah.
It's there must be some plastic or something she put in there.
It's just all the scar tissue and I don't know. I
Yes.
mean, it's bad. It was a bad thing.
Oh, that's that. And I might be going from Jersey back to Pennsylvania to the Pittsburgh area to visit some family. So most of the rest of the year, I'm not going to be in Baltimore. I'll be finishing novels on the road. I'm just finishing history books while I'm home because I need access to the library.
All right.
So
you're also doing research kind of in different places that you visit too. You do some research there in Maryland, and
yes,
you look into local resources. So that's good too.
I just found the record of the man who I think might be the last white slave in Maryland, David Holliday. He was freed in 1837. He was described as about 37 years of age.
Oh, wow.
They didn't know what he was.
Yeah. Were they freeing everybody at that time? Or what?
This is only in Frederick County, Maryland. Didn't have a real big population. A man named Henry Schley was the county clerk, and he must have been the freedom angel for a whole lot of people. He signed hundreds of manumissions over the course of the 1830s. And he did this predominantly for Negroes. That's what they were called. So if I was a black man and I got manumitted in 1837, I would be referred to as Negro Man James. Okay, that was in Maryland. That's that was said, and they designate if they're mulatto or if they're Negro, if they're colored, which would be mixed race. They didn't really use quadroon or octoroon in Maryland as a term, just Negro, mulatto, and colored. And one woman who was yellow, who had the same last name as her owner.
Oh.
Her name was Nancy Dorsey, a yellow woman. I did find previous records of Chinese people enslaved in Maryland around 1700.
Wow.
Now, she could have been, that could have been an indication that she was what they would call in Virginia high yellow, just being very light cast, but that's unusual in Maryland, and there was a history of Asians being enslaved in Maryland all through the 1700s, not in a lot of numbers. So that's just some of the stuff I found today.
Well, I think that's probably enough for a quick little podcast. So that was episode 40 of the Crackpot Podcast, LaFond and Lockhart. Thanks a lot, James.
Thank you, Ann.
What do you want? There is no more. If you find a place, please let me know. Take me with you when you go. Take me with you when you go. Take me with you when you go.